गुड मॉर्निंग सर। हेलो सर, गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग।
कैसे हैं सर आप?
बस ठीक है ठीक है। आप बताएं कैसे हैं।
मैं बढ़िया हूँ सर। सर, आवर स्पीकर इज रेडी, बट हम 12 बजे ही स्टार्ट करेंगे।
12 बजे। हाँ बिल्कुल बिल्कुल। स्पीकर कहाँ है। स्पीकर तो मुझे नजर नहीं आ रहा इसमें।
सर, अभी हमने उनको इन्फॉर्म करना है।
अच्छा
ही इज रेडी वेटिंग ऑन व्हाट्सएप। तो जैसे ही मैं उनको इन्फॉर्म करूंगा सर, ही विल ज्वाइन द लिंक ग्रुप।
ओके अमरीश ओके।
ओके।
अच्छा आप मुझे वो बना देना क्या क्या ताकि
हाँ
मैं अपनी
जी,
मेरी मेरी स्क्रीन शेयर हो सके। पोस्ट
मैंने आपको को होस्ट बना दिया सर।
बना दीजिए। बिल्कुल बिल्कुल।
जी।
सर भी हैं। सर नमस्कार, सर नमस्कार, पंकज सर नमस्कार, सर आपकी वॉल्यूम नहीं आ रही है पंकज सर।
अच्छा अब आवाज आ रही है। हेलो
जी सर ऑडिबल।
हाँ महेश कैसे हो?
बस सर बढ़िया, आप बताएं कैसे हैं?
अच्छा, फर्स्ट क्लास।
गुड सर गुड,
बस बढ़िया। मुझे शक्ल देख के पहचान तो आ गई थी, मैंने कहा
अच्छी बात है सर, मैंने भी एकदम देखा उनकी सर है ये तो।
हाँ मैं आज ऑफिस से आया हुआ था, मैंने कहा चलो ऑफिस से ही ऑन कर लूँ फिर।
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल सर, अच्छा किया।
और कैसे हो, क्या चल रहा है?
बस सर ठीक है सर, बढ़िया चल रहा है। हम भी ऑफिस में ही है, मैं भी ऑफिस में आया हूँ अभी।
अच्छा ये तुम्हारा ऑफिस है?
जी सर हाँ।
तो वो सीएनसी का था, मैंने कहा चलो फिर तुम्हें ज्वाइन करना ही पड़ेगा।
हाँ सर बिल्कुल, आपके आपके रिसर्च एरिया से भी रिलेटेड है तो ठीक है सर, बिल्कुल बढ़िया है।
तो अभी किस टाइम शुरू करोगे? एट 12?
हाँ सर बिल्कुल, स्टार्ट होने वाला है बस थोड़ी देर में, विद इन 5 to 7 minutes वी विल स्टार्ट।
वीडियो ऑफ कर लूँ क्या ये?
हाँ सर ऑफ कर लीजिए वीडियो, उसमें कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं, वीडियो ऑफ कर लीजिए, क्योंकि वीडियो ऑन रहती है ना तो जूम पे भी थोड़ी सी प्रॉब्लम आती है सर।
देखा है वो खुद करना था, देखो शायद शायद इधर पर
उमलेश जी,
अच्छा क्षेत्र को अच्छा तो लिस्ट में तुम्हारे उन्होंने शायद ना फैकल्टी फैकल्टी को कर दिया मुझे ऐसा लग रहा है। पॉइंट ले लियो लिंक कर सकता है। आया हुआ था क्या अभी आया?
विमलेश जी
बैठ सकते हो?
हेलो,
सुबह एक सेशन तो कर लिया ना, वो इनॉग्रल वाला होता है 12 बजे फिर इन्होंने भी शुरू कर दिया, ये तो शुरू हुआ नहीं।
सर मैं 8-10 मिनट में मिलके फिर मैं करता हूँ इतना हूँ। गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
मॉर्निंग जी।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर। सर स्टार्ट किया जाए?
हाँ वी कैन स्टार्ट यस।
जी सर, जी सर, प्लीज। सर विजिबल है ना मेरी पीपीटीज हैं?
यस सर यू आर विजिबल सर।
ओके विनेश। हेलो हेलो एवरीवन, आई एम डॉक्टर महेश चंद, कोऑर्डिनेटर ऑफ दिस सेशन। नाउ वी हैव डॉक्टर इंद्रदीप सिंह जी, ही इज द प्रोफेसर इन मैकेनिकल एंड इंडस्ट्रियल इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट एट आईआईटी रुड़की। IIT Roorkee, and he has total 15 years of wide experience in teaching and research on composite materials, and he has more than 240 research papers in reputed international national journals and in the conferences, and he is also the reviewer of more than 25 national and international reputed journals, and he also has been completed and doing many research projects with the National Research Foundation of Korea, IMPRINT, DST, MHRD, and AICT sponsored. And there are some achievements about Dr. Inderdeep Singh. He received the Outstanding Teacher Award in 2013 by IIT Roorkee. He also received the Best Industrial Relevant PhD Thesis during his PhD in 2004-05 by IIT Delhi, and he is also holding the first positions in BTech Mechanical Engineering from NIT Hamirpur, and he has completed his Masters and PhD from IIT Delhi, and he is also besides these academics, he is also a good sportsman, and he has a outstanding sportsman for the year of 2000 by the Board of Sports Activities in IIT Delhi, and in sports he has also received 2 gold medals, 6 silver and 2 bronze medal at Inter IIT Sport Meet in hockey and the football. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Inderdeep sir. Now you please hold the session. And please start your session. Sir, please. Inderdeep sir, please start.
I think you have to allow me to share my screen.
Sure, sir, sure.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Mahesh, for detailed introduction.
Thank you, sir.
Can I share my screen now?
Yes, sir, please.
It is showing, it is giving me a message that host displayed, host disabled participant screen sharing.
Sir, please try once again, sir.
Okay. Yeah, now it is possible. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Welcome, sir.
Can you see my screen, full screen?
Yes, sir, visible.
Okay, so thank you very much, Professor Sanjeev, Professor Mahesh, and other participants for giving me this opportunity to present the research work that we are doing at IIT Roorkee. So I'll try to give you a glimpse of different aspects of the research that we are doing at IIT Roorkee. So as clearly pointed out by a professor in the introduction, our major target is towards development of composite materials. And since I am from manufacturing, so our target is towards cost-effective, high-quality manufacturing of composite materials. Because once we talk about composite materials, there are different domains and different research directions in which the research scientists, engineers, professionals are working. So if you see, this is an interdisciplinary field. There are faculty members, research scientists involved in the field of composite materials, starting from basic sciences, for example, chemistry, physics, even mathematics. People are trying to model composite materials using different techniques. So starting from basic sciences, that is physics and chemistry, to going to engineering, for example, chemical engineering, mechanical engineering, textile engineering, production engineering, aerospace, aircraft, and maybe there are other host a large number of engineering departments where the research faculty members or faculty members conducting research in the field of composite materials. So our target within the broader domain of composite materials is that we want to manufacture the composite materials correctly. So maybe the design of the composite material may have come from the design department. So they may have already identified the stacking sequence of the composite materials. They may have already identified the fibers which are going to be used, the matrix, that is the polymer that is going to be used. So the design may be done by another team. Our team is majorly focusing on the manufacturing of composite materials. And as we will see in today's session, that how to manufacture and what are the challenges in manufacturing of composite materials. So for the broader understanding of just a minute. Aajo sign. Okay, sorry. So the broader idea of discussion is that how to make the composite materials, and then I'll try to share that how to start manufacturing, and the target that you see on our screen today, knowledge base for making good quality holes in fiber reinforced plastics. So starting with the title, if you see, we have three important things here, which I have already spoken. First thing is the knowledge base. So the knowledge base, we will try to see that what is the knowledge base that we have tried to create. Now the second thing is, as I told you, good quality, high production and maybe cost effective manufacturing of holes. So that is the second our process that we are trying to focus is making of good quality holes. And the third thing are the materials, that what materials we are going to focus. The materials will be fiber reinforced plastics. So to start with, we need to understand that there are three broad domains of our topic that we are going to cover today. So first, to start with, maybe we can say there will be materials, then these materials will be processed, and then for processing we will see what are the challenges, and finally we will try to see that what is the knowledge base that can help the engineers and scientists. Because these materials are maybe a wide variety of materials can be developed, so the variety is huge. For example, if you are making a hole in a metallic material, maybe the drill material or the tool material that you are going to use may not change significantly. Maybe for one grade of steel, if you are using a particular tool material, another grade of steel also a metallic tool will only be used. Maybe slight modification may be there in the tool. But here, when we talk about the composite materials, you have different grades of fibers. You can have glass fiber, you can have carbon fiber, you can have Kevlar fiber, and currently we are talking about natural fiber. There are hundreds of natural fibers. Even the human hair is a natural fiber. So there are hundreds of natural fibers, hundreds of types of polymer blends, polymers which are available. So we have a wide variety or a very, very large family of materials at our disposal. Now, how to make holes in these materials? It requires understanding of the whole process. And another thing is that once we have a big idea of making holes or a big data, how to bring that data into the knowledge base so that the user need not read 200 or 300 or 500 papers to get answer to his simple query. Now, that knowledge base can be a software which can be integrated into the machine, or which can be integrated into the computer system which is controlling the machine, so that a user only inputs that this is my workpiece material, this is the tool material I want to use, this is the hole diameter I want to create. So obviously then the knowledge base may be able to produce the information or generate the information or predict the information for the user, so that the user need not run around and find out research articles that how to make hole in this type of a composite material. So we can say that knowledge base is kind of a digital library which is integrated into the system which is controlling the machine. And there, if you give the input of your material, I will show you a few case studies that you input the material, you input the diameter, you input the other input parameters like speed and feed. The knowledge base will give you the forces and the damage that will take place. So if the damage is much beyond your required damage, you can subsequently change the conditions, and you can change the conditions means you can change the speed and feed so that you are able to get a good quality hole. So the title is knowledge base for making good quality holes in fiber reinforced plastics. So we start with this topic with the basic understanding of the composite materials. So first, I think these days composite materials is a common topic, everybody knows. So I am not going to go into the details of the composite material, just a basic understanding of the composite materials you can see on your screen. So the composite materials, they form a material system which is composed of a mixture or a combination of two or more macro constituents. So on your screen you can see the macro constituents, there are fibers and there are polymers. So you combine the fiber and polymer to make a composite material. So these are the samples that we make for testing. So we can make a bigger sample also for making hole. These are smaller samples. These are ASTM standard samples for finding out the tensile properties of the composite material. So we can make different types of samples. So I will show you some of the equipment that we have at IIT Roorkee. Then this is called the polymer, and this is called the fiber, and this is the matrix, and this is the reinforcement. So since we are talking about fiber reinforced plastics, so this is the fiber, it is acting as the reinforcement, and what is being reinforced, the plastics are being reinforced. So this is the plastic which is getting reinforced. So it is fiber reinforced plastic, and this is the material which is getting formed. So based on the matrix material, we have polymer matrix composites, we have metal matrix composites, and we have ceramic matrix composites. So this is the matrix material, and there can be different types of reinforcement. So we can have a continuous reinforcement, we can have a discontinuous randomly oriented reinforcement, we can have an aligned reinforcement in which all the small fibers are oriented in one direction only. So we have different types of reinforcement. So the composite materials can even be classified based on the Professor Mahesh, is there any other co-host also?
Ji sir.
So I am getting regular on my screen. People are still joining, so maybe you can allow them one by one. Like now Talari Thimappa has entered the waiting room for this meeting. This message I am getting on the screen. So you
Okay sir. We are
in meeting. Focusing on this though, maybe I am not able to concentrate. Again, Samamit Rana has entered the waiting room.
Okay sir, we are admitting sir.
So you keep on admitting people who are joining, so I will focus on more on my presentation.
Okay sir.
So here we see that we have different types of composite materials. Our target is on fiber reinforced plastics. So fiber which is reinforcing the plastics. But those of you who are interested in reading further about composite materials, the composites can also be classified based on the nature and type of the fibers that you are using, whether they are continuous or discontinuous. So then we go to the next slide. So normally, these are the families of composite materials. As I told you in the previous slide, the polymer is the matrix and the fibers are the reinforcement. So these type of fibers are the synthetic fiber reinforced composite. So all these fibers are synthetic fibers, you can see on your screen, carbon fiber, glass fiber and Kevlar fiber. And then there can be different types of matrix materials like thermosetting polymers and thermoplastic polymers. This is just a representative list. There can be a large family of thermoplastic and thermosetting polymers which can be reinforced by different types of fiber. So here we are only talking about synthetic fiber reinforced composites, as the title is related to fiber reinforced composites. So first we will try to have just a basic idea of composite materials. Otherwise there are books and books written on composite materials, you can refer to those books. Our target is to relate our lecture to the focus area of this FDB program, which is automation, and I think CNC and automation, some focus is on a specific domain. So we want to focus on that domain. So quickly, I will talk about these materials and then focus my attention towards the focused area of the, or the focused title of this program. So this is a composite, a family of composite material. Now you suppose you take glass fiber as the reinforcement, and from thermosetting polymers you take epoxy. So you use epoxy as the matrix material and glass fiber as the composite fiber material or reinforcement, and you can make a glass fiber reinforced epoxy matrix composites. So you, first thing is you need to understand that there are two important phases in any composite material. One is the reinforcement phase, another one is the matrix phase. Why I am emphasizing on these points is because they will contribute individually towards their machining behavior. A matrix will respond differently to machining, and the reinforcement will respond differently to the machining action. And therefore, we need to understand that these are multi-phase material, heterogeneous, anisotropic materials, and therefore we have to be very, very careful while making holes in the composite materials. And we will try to see in the subsequent slides what kind of damage takes place once we try to make a hole in the composite material. But currently, if you see the target in the previous slide, synthetic fiber reinforced composite. So synthetic fiber reinforced composites are generally non-biodegradable in nature. And these days there is a lot of focus on biodegradable materials, sustainable materials. As we can see during the COVID-19 situation also, we are having lot of cleansing action which has taken place for the environment. Ganges or Ganga, Mother Ganga is flowing through nearby us. We see lot of change has taken place. The quality of water has become potable. For so many years it was non-potable, but now even we can drink directly water from the Ganga. It is so clean now. So there are important aspects which we need to look towards the environment. So the sustainable materials, sustainable manufacturing, green materials, all these type of ideas have now being started to be discussed among the research fraternity, research brotherhood. People are now thinking that how to conduct research in areas which will help the environment to further grow. And in that direction, we are also working. So we are now working on natural fiber reinforced composition. Earlier, there was a program conducted by the university, our J.C. Bose University in Faridabad, and I delivered a complete lecture on natural fiber reinforced composite. So today that is not our target, but I am just touching this topic that focus is on natural fiber composites, where the reinforcement, as we have seen in the previous slide, as you can see, carbon, glass and Kevlar is now being changed by natural fibers. Natural fibers can be jute fibers, coir fibers, hemp fibers, Grevy Optiva, sisal. There can be different types, even human hair. There are animal-based fibers which can come from the wool of the sheep. We can have plant-based fibers, cotton, coir. There are different types, banana fiber. There is a long list of natural fibers which can be used as reinforcement in the polymer composites. So we can see that target is towards developing partially green and fully green. Many times, many researchers or young scholars, research scholars, they have this question, how to differentiate between a fully green composite and a partially green composite. The partially green is that one of the constituents, as we have seen, there is a matrix and a reinforcement. So either the matrix or the reinforcement has to be derived from natural resources. Similarly, for fully green composites, both the constituents, the polymers as well as, for example, the matrix as well as the reinforcement, must be derived from the natural resources. So we are now focusing our attention on fully biodegradable green composites. This is the classification of fiber reinforced composite materials you can see on the screen. So currently, whatever I have shown, synthetic fiber reinforced polymer composites, synthetic fibers, I'll take the pointer. So synthetic fiber reinforced composites are being made in which non-biodegradable polymers like epoxy are being used. So you have a non-biodegradable epoxy, and then you have a synthetic fiber like carbon or graphite or glass, and then you combine them together, you will get a non-biodegradable composites. Whereas in the trend now towards is the trend now is towards natural fibers, which are green and biodegradable polymers, and you combine them together to get a fully biodegradable composite. So from the materials point of view, I have tried to highlight that what were the previous composites which were used, which are synthetic fiber like carbon fiber, glass fiber, Kevlar fiber, reinforced epoxy or polyester. So all those were the materials which were in research for last 34 years, and we see lot of applications of those materials. But now the trend in the next 10 years, I think, will be towards development of sustainable materials. I have not included today in my session, but yesterday I was delivering a lecture online at NIT Bhopal, and there I showed few applications of COVID-19. Okay, so am I audible, Mahesh?
Ha sir, audible sir, you are audible.
Okay. Yes,
sir.
What I see is that yesterday I was delivering one lecture at NIT Bhopal in one FDP program. So there I showed few examples of these natural fiber based composite materials. They are now being used by the Western countries, especially one example case study we have seen, in which in Italy they were able to make very simple and very quick to fabricate structures or for these keeping these COVID-19 patients for in isolation. So very quickly they made these natural fiber based composite materials in the factory and brought them at a place and assembled them, and then with solid partitioning walls, people were kept in isolation who were infected by the COVID-19. So there are a lot of applications for these materials because these are sustainable, they are derived from natural resources, and then they have another advantage that after the life, they can be easily disposed of into the environment without causing any harmful effect. So then we see some of the processes which can be used for making these composite materials, that is natural fiber based composite materials. We have fibers, we have polymer pellets, we combine them together, and then using the direct injection molding process, we can inject them into the mold cavity, and this type of samples we can make. So since we are conducting research, we are trying to use different types of fibers after treatment, before treatment, what are the changes in the properties, taking different types of polymers. So therefore we are not making a product, but we are trying to make the tensile coupons, the flexural specimen, the impact specimen, so that we check that what are the properties that we can achieve by blending the fibers and the polymers together. So we can get the samples like this, which is giving you a clear picture. So these are three samples. So we can see PL, P2, PL, P2, PL, P2. So the same samples are made 3-4 times so that we get uniform properties and check the variability in the properties with different samples. So you can see that very easily we can blend the fibers and the polymers together using the direct injection molding process so that we are able to make the sample. So this machine we have at IIT Roorkee, where we can make natural fiber based composite materials, which is a standard equipment. Then the second process that we are using is the extrusion injection molding process. So this is extrusion process. All of us know about the extrusion process. Through extrusion, we are making the composite pellets, and these pellets we are then feeding as the input to our injection molding machine. These pellets we can even put in compression molding also. That is also another area where we can work. But right now we are using these polymer pellets which are coming out of the extrusion machine, and we are putting them into the injection molding machine to make the samples like this. So this is the process, is extrusion injection molding. First we are extruding and then we are injection molding into the composite specimen. These are the samples that are being fabricated. Then the third process that we are using is the extrusion compression molding. So the extrusion process remains same. The only difference here is that I will go back again, that we are not palletizing here. In extrusion process, we get a strand or a wire which we pull down and then we palletize. Palletize means we cut it into standard size, which is shown here. These are the pallets. So in extrusion, we extrude the fiber and the polymer together and then we pull it in the form of a wire and then cut it into the specific size of the pallets. And these pallets we use as input for the injection molding. So here we can see in the next process that we are not palletizing now. What we are doing, we are collecting this wire in a mold. And you will be able to appreciate this is the wire which is coming out. It is a blended wire of fiber and the polymer, and this is being collected. Here it is being collected openly, but normally we collect it in a mold. And then this mold is taken to the compression molding machine and we can make a sheet. So our mold is of 30 centimeter by 30 centimeter. So we can have a mold of 30 centimeter by 30 centimeter and then we can make a composite plate like this using the compression molding process. So we are extruding, means we are blending the fiber and the polymer using the extrusion process. And this output of the extrusion process we are using in the compression molding process to make the laminates or sheets of composite materials. So you can see on the screen, there is another sheet. This is a sheet which is made. We can see 30 centimeter by 30 centimeter is the maximum size that we can get. And there are small fibers here, which are uniformly distributed in the polymer. There, this type of sheets we can make from the waste polymers also and waste fibers also. Now this is the topic that we are going to discuss today. I think I have taken a lot of time for the introduction. So this is the major topic that we are going to discuss today, that is the machining or how to make good quality holes in composite materials. So for those who are new to the composite materials, although I feel that maximum people or who are studying engineering these days or who are conducting some kind of research or masters or PhD students normally know about these materials. So, but still I spent around 15 to 20 minutes time on explaining the basic concept of the composite materials. So now we come to the machining aspects of composite materials, which is a big challenge for the researchers. So we can see, we need to understand, we will try to find answer to some of these questions in our subsequent slides. So we can see why machining is required, what are the issues to be looked into, why is it still a challenge. So still people, just I think 2 weeks back I received one article in which authors from a different country, they are working on the machining aspects of composite materials. So still in 2020 also there are research groups across the world who are trying to work, do their research in this area of drilling or machining of composite materials. So why is it still a challenge, that we will try to see, and what are the remedies proposed till date, we will try to understand, and then what are the future directions to look for, we will try to answer these questions. So right now the first question is answered on the screen itself with the help of two diagrams. Why machining is required, you can see on the screen. This is one automotive door panel. This is a automotive door panel. So we have 50% Canuff fiber and 50% polypropylene. So this is 50% natural fiber, 50% polypropylene matrix. So matrix is a polymer and reinforcement or fibers are natural fiber. So here we see number of holes are there. So we can directly make this part in injection molding, but then maybe at a later stage we may require holes to assemble this to the actual door of the car. Now why these holes are required, you can easily understand that they are required for the assembly purpose. But there are challenges associated with making holes in composite material. And the challenge is that 60% of the holes are rejected. This is not our data, this is data which is already published in the books. If you read, I think it is Mechanics of Composite Materials by Professor R.M. Jones, in the first or second chapter he has highlighted that the machining induced damage is one of the biggest problems for composite materials. So this is the 60% rejection rate, which is a big challenge. And here we see that when we have to join two different parts together, titanium and carbon fiber reinforced plastic, so when we have to join the two parts together, we require number of holes either to do mechanical fastening or to use riveting process to join the different materials. So we can require holes for joining similar materials, we can require holes to join dissimilar materials, but joining or assembly operations are definitely required to make a composite product which is intricate in shape. So simpler products can be directly made by injection molding, but complex products require the assembly operation, and for assembly we need the holes, and these holes will create a problem in the form of 60% rejection. Now why there is a problem in this, we can see. So what are the challenges? Now we will try to see that what are the different types of challenges, and we will try to understand it with the help of the diagrams. So first are the anisotropic nature of the FRP composite materials. So why I discussed about the materials in the beginning of today's session, because now we will be using the term FRP, which is fiber reinforced plastic. So I have already told what is the reinforcement, what is the matrix. So here the matrix is a plastic and the reinforcement is a fiber. So this is anisotropic in nature. Why they are anisotropic? Because the properties are different in X, Y, and Z direction. So since the properties are different, once you try to make a hole, the hole may not be a completely circular, because there are property gradient in the longitudinal direction, it can be there, in the transverse direction it can be there, and certainly it is there in the Z direction. So therefore there are challenges how to make a good quality hole in a material which is not having consistent or uniform properties in the bulk. The second is the difference in the properties of the constituents. So therefore I showed two different images, one of a fiber, another one of a polymer. So fiber will have different chemical and physical properties. The polymer will have its own characteristics, maybe physical characteristics, chemical characteristics. So polymer when blended with fiber, both of them have to be machined using similar conditions, same conditions, both will respond differently. So the difference in the properties of the constituents is also a big challenge. Then the highly abrasive nature of the typical fibers. For example, the glass fibers are typically very, very abrasive in nature. And it is already reported in one of the articles, I think long back, 25 years back, that if you try to make holes in glass fiber reinforced epoxy composite materials using high speed steel drill, normally we use HSS drills only, so you will not be able to make more than 10 holes. So within 10 holes only the tool will wear out, the drill will wear out so fast that you will not be able to make any further holes. Why? Because the glass fibers are very, very abrasive in nature. So therefore the highly abrasive nature of the typical fiber sometimes is also a big challenge for making good quality holes in composite materials. And then the next is the stacking sequence. So we can see that these materials are tailorable materials. Tailorable means that we can tailor these materials as per our specific requirements. So once we can tailor them, means we can very easily select the number of layers that we want to put in the composite material. So normally using the classical plate bending theory, there are different theories which are analytical in nature, in which authors and researchers have suggested that we should always go for even number of layers. I sometimes receive some research articles where the authors are ignorant of the fact and they select 5 layers or 7 layers or odd number of layers. So normally it is suggested that we should always, the classical lamination theory suggests that mostly we must go for even number of layers. So the stacking sequence, if we lay one layer, another layer, another layer, so suppose we make 8 layers, so these 8 layers can be made up of same material, they can be made up of different materials. So therefore once the drill will enter into the composite, so it will encounter different layers at different thickness or different through the thickness of the laminate. So maybe at 4 mm, after going 4 mm inside the laminate, there may be 2 layers of even metallic sheets which are important from the design of the composite point of view. So when we are designing the composite, we may like to have 2 layers of metals inside the glass fiber or carbon fiber sheets. So therefore through the thickness of the laminate, the drill is encountering different materials, and therefore the drill wear is one challenge, and then how drill will respond to cutting different materials, that is another challenge. So the stacking sequence also is very, 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 very important in defining the machining behavior of the composite material. And then the most important, that is the target for our session, is the machining induced damage. That the damage that takes place around the hole or at the edge, if you are doing edge trimming or any other machining operation, the damage that takes place, we will see, try to understand and see it with the help of some diagrams. Machining induced damage is a big challenge. And then to the decision to use a coolant or to avoid the coolant is another challenge. Now in composite material, since we are talking about fiber reinforced plastics, so the forces that are generated are not very, very high. So if the forces are not high, the temperature also somehow is not very, very high. Although none of the researchers has significantly or exhaustively worked in the field of investigating the temperature development in the drilling of composite materials or machining, there are few articles but not that exhaustive that we can establish a fact based on the outcome of those research articles. So there are still opportunities to work in the temperature generation or temperature behavior of drilling of natural fiber or synthetic fiber based composite material. But the decision to use a coolant, why I am saying this, is because once you see that when the damage is taking place around the hole, there will be micro cavities or micro cracks that will develop, and this coolant may get into the cracks because of the capillary action and then may stay there and may affect the long term performance of the composite structures which have holes. So therefore we have to be very, very judicious and very, very careful that whether we should select a coolant for doing the cutting action or should we do the machining without using any coolant. And then lastly, there are health hazards also which are challenging. Now health hazards basically can be that if we talk about glass fibers are carcinogenic in nature, and once you machine, we normally do not get, suppose you are using glass fiber and the matrix is epoxy, so both are brittle in nature, so both shows the brittle behavior, brittle characteristics. So if you are trying to make a hole, you will not get a continuous chip, you get a chip in the powdered form. So this powdered form, if inhaled, or maybe some dust which is generated inhaled, is not good for our health. So therefore, we should be very, very careful while making holes in glass fiber based composite materials. So because there are some health hazards also. So suppose you are doing research, you may be doing maybe 10 to 15, 20, 30 holes a day. Maybe that may not be a big challenge, but if you are using this at an industrial scale and the workers are doing hole making in glass fiber composites throughout the day, so then it can be a challenge, which can be a work hazard, which must be avoided, or proper care must be taken in terms of putting the masks and other protective equipment. So these are the challenges that we need to address. And the biggest challenge in this is the machining induced damage. So we will see in the subsequent slide, you will be able to appreciate that since our target is related to drilling, we are also highlighting the challenges related to drilling. Most of the challenges are same. If you can see rapid tool wear, drilling induced delamination, which is a specific damage form related to the drilling action, which we will see with the help of the diagram. Then fiber pullout, matrix burning, because which is related to the temperature. I told you many researchers have till now not explored the temperature profiles during the drilling of composite materials. Still opportunities do exist. Then heat buildup due to low thermal conductivity of the composite constituents. Then difficult to attain dimensional accuracy. We will see in the diagrams that how the dimensional accuracy cannot be achieved, and difficult to attain the good surface finish of the whole wall surface. So therefore, these are specific challenges related to making good quality holes. And if you remember, our target of our session is that a knowledge base for making good quality holes in composite materials or fiber reinforced composites. So here you can see that these are the big challenges that we have to take care of when we are trying to make holes in composite materials. So I think the next diagram that will come on your screen, you can see this is peel up and push out type of delamination. So here we can see, as I told you, that we make the composites layer by layer by layer. So these are the different layers that we can see, and the drill is entering and trying to make a hole in a composite material or a laminated composite material. So you can see here that when the drill tries to enter into the laminate, at the top the layers have a tendency, this is a peel up delamination. So here the layers have a tendency to move up along the rotation of the drill. So drill is rotating as well as it is going down. It has a feed rate, so it is going down and it has a cutting speed. So there we see here that it is peel up type of delamination may take place. Peel up, peeling up action. Like we peel off the banana, we peel off oranges. So that is the peeling up action taking place at the top layers. So which is called as the peel up type of delamination. Now normally these composite materials, I have shown you some processes like injection molding, extrusion injection molding, compression molding. Specifically compression molding is used for making continuous fiber laminates. I think I can show you one of the laminates. Show you the yellow one, continuous fiber. This one, yellow. Bring all. Keep it. Another one is there. Not this. So if you can see this, this is a laminate. If you can, I am bringing it close to the camera. If you can appreciate the fibers. The fibers are running in both the direction. So fibers are in the warp and the weft. So therefore the textile engineers are also equally important in composite material. And this is the thickness. So thickness has four layers of this fiber, woven mat form. So when the drill will try to enter into this laminate, suppose this is the drill. So when it will try to enter into the laminate, it will have the peeling up action. And when it will try to exit, towards the exit side, we will get a push down type of delamination. So we have a peel up type of delamination action, we have a push down type of delamination action, and the other form of the damage you can see in this diagram, that you have, our target is to make this white circle. This is the exact dimension of the hole that we want, and this we can easily achieve in a metallic material. So show me that fixture. Compressive fixture with holes, only one with the holes, with hole. So in this fixture, if you see, these are metallic holes. So if you see the hole is good quality hole. There is no damage, it's a metallic hole. But if you compare this metallic hole with this hole which is made in a composite material, you can see the damage that has taken. Now the researchers are trying to find out the means and mechanisms of making good quality holes in these composite materials. And this can only be done with integration of the various techniques, various tools, and what can be the various methods of reducing this damage. What is the summary of around 200 research articles which have only focused on making good quality holes? What are the various techniques they have tried to investigate experimentally or by modeling, that how to reduce this damage that is taking place? And I must also mention here that these are the materials which are used in the aircraft industry today. Unfortunately, in this presentation, I could not show that in the aircraft in which we travel, 50 to 60% of the materials are composite materials. So if while making the hole, there is this much of damage that is taking place, you can yourself imagine that what will be the reliability of the aircrafts that we are traveling in. So for that, they may be, as I have already told you, that there are 60% rejection rate. So still we are getting 40% of holes which are of excellent quality. So we have to reduce this 60% rejection rate by developing tools, techniques, strategies which can help us to create holes in as per the desired specifications. So what are those techniques we will try to understand? So these are the challenges, as I have already told you. Now this is the setup that we created at IIT Roorkee. So this is a normal CNC machine. but we have included a dynamometer, which is a four component piezoelectric drill dynamometer. So we can measure the torque, we can measure the thrust force, which are the two important forces in any drilling action. So these are the various types of drill geometries that we have investigated, but this is showing only one, which is the step drill point. And this is the hole you can see. If you go to the previous slide, if you see, white circle is the actual hole that we want to create. But around the hole, we see there is few areas, much area which is damaged. So this is the area around the hole. This is the actual experimental image of one of the holes which we created at IIT. So this, some of you may be wondering why it is green in color. So we have tried to use the non-destructive dye penetrant testing to find out the area around the hole which has been damaged. So here it is a fluorescent dye which has been used, which is glowing under the ultraviolet light. So this is the technique that we use for quantifying. Normally, if you go back to this diagram, our knowledge base will only be created. Our critical thrust force model or critical feed rate model can only be created if you know that what is the area around the hole. So many researchers normally use the normal visual examination technique to understand that where the damage is more and in which case the damage is less. So here also we can see the black area outline is showing the area which has damaged. So it is very difficult to calculate that how much area around the hole has been damaged. So normally they take this as the delamination maximum diameter. So this is the dotted circle outside the hole. This is the delamination, because delamination has gone up to this point. So we can see this is the maximum delamination diameter and this is the actual hole dia that we wanted. So then they take a ratio of the two and then they call it as a delamination factor. This is a published by Faraz et al. In 2009. So this is one delamination factor which is used to quantify the area which has been damaged around the hole. So this delamination factor, as you can see on your screen, is not the true depiction of the damaged area, because you see this area is not damaged, this area. But still, because the factor that we have chosen is taking the maximum diameter up to which damage has gone, so we are taking this complete diameter as the damaged diameter, and then we are taking this as the actual hole diameter. So therefore, the area representation gives a better idea, and therefore we developed this method. Therefore, we developed this method to actually quantify the exact area around the hole which has been damaged. And then we try to relate this damage with the different drill point geometries, as you can see on your screen. So we try to understand the actual drilling behavior of suppose this is an example of one drill point geometry. This is one. So we can have different drill point geometries. Maybe if I correctly remember, in 1987, there is a professor, Joseph Miller. He published a two-page article, only two pages, on drilling behavior of graphite epoxy composite material. And he investigated 17 drill point geometries way back, maybe 33 years back. And he found out that the drill geometry has a significant effect on the machining behavior of composite materials. Now some of you may start to think then why we are doing this research now, that when 30 years back a professor has already investigated the 17 drill point geometry. So the important point is that he was not able to explain that why the damage is more in this drill point geometry as compared to another drill point geometry. So the inter-drill comparison he could not scientifically establish. He has done thousands of experiments, and based on his visual perception, visual examination of the hole, he was able to propose that these two drill geometries give better quality holes based on his visual perception of the quality in terms of the damage around the holes. But now, maybe 30 years down the line, we developed this process 15 years back when I was doing my PhD. So we developed this very, very simple process, and we were able to quantify these holes around the damage around these holes, and we were able to relate it to the drill point geometry, we were able to relate it to the cutting speed, we were able to relate it to the feed rate, and with different types of stacking sequence we investigated that in which case the damage is more and in which case the damage is less. And then the forces that we get from the dynamometer can also be investigated in depth, and we can see here that we have analyzed this signal and compared it with the drilling action taking place by this drill. This is a step drill, as you can see. So it will perform the drilling action in two stages. The inner portion or the central portion will do the pre-drilling, and the outer secondary cutting edges will enlarge the already generated hole by the central portion of the drill. So it will do the drilling in two stages, and the two stages are, you can see, which are explained here with the help of this thrust force diagram. So the inner portion is completing the drilling action up to this stage. See, at BC the inner portion has already entered into the drill, BC, and after CD the outer portion has come. From C to D the force is increasing. Why it is increasing from C to D? Because now the outer portion or the secondary cutting edge of the drill is coming in contact with the workpiece or the composite laminate. So this way we can conduct a lot of research. If the material will change, obviously the results will change. If the drill will change, the behavior of the forces will be changed, it will be different, and then we can correlate. Maybe I normally, while delivering lectures on this topic, I normally say that it is kind of a x-ray for the doctors. Like the doctors look at the x-ray and they are able to pinpoint that where the fracture has taken place, or what is the severity of the fracture, whether it is a hairline fracture or a complete bone has broken into two pieces. So all that kind of understanding we can easily develop by using this type of signals. So here we are only seeing the thrust force signal. We can also get the torque signal, we can also get the other two components of the forces and try to correlate that how the forces are changing with the change in the drill point geometry. And then we can design our drill as per the requirements of our tool or requirements of our material. And our target is to reduce this damage around the hole. So this area has seen lot of development, lot of data is available. So what we have tried to do is that we have tried to collect all this information which we have generated as a research team, which other research teams across the world have generated, and try to bring it into a knowledge base, which is kind of a software which can be easily used by researchers or engineers or even by students. So I will go to that. This is the background that we also did a lot of experiments to generate a lot of data which will be used as an input for the prediction of forces and prediction of damage. So here we can see from this diagram what are the input parameters for any drilling action. So the input parameters are the cutting speed, the feed rate, the material in which we have to make the hole or the laminate, which is shown here by red color. So the cutting speed, feed rate, and the material can be the major input parameters, and the output can be the forces that we are getting and the damage that is being recorded for the composite laminate. So output is the damage and the forces, input is the parameters which I have already told. So then we go to the next slide. So the background of research, this is a summary of what I have already spoken. So the major issue involved in secondary manufacturing. Now secondary manufacturing, why? Because now we are focusing on the machining which will be used for joining all the two or three different parts together. So primary manufacturing is I make this part in injection molding or compression molding. I make this part using, suppose, vacuum bag molding, two different processes for composite material. But now secondary manufacturing is I have to join them together. So joining is one secondary manufacturing, machining is another secondary manufacturing process. So the major challenge is the machining induced damage. Then the efforts have been put worldwide by researchers to minimize this damage. And there are different approaches, some of them are listed here, that is optimization of the operating variables, how to choose the cutting speed and the feed rate. I have shown you one example of tool geometry modification, and then theoretical modeling. People have around the world, they have proposed critical thrust force models. that if the thrust force during this drilling action is beyond this model or beyond this value, it will definitely lead to damage around the pole. So we have to try to control the thrust force within the specific limits, less than the critical thrust force. So those kind of theoretical models are also available in literature. And for people who are designing the machine tools, they have already used these models as the control mechanism. Now what is being done in the design of the machine tools is that using the dynamometer, the forces are being continuously recorded. And as soon as the force go 10% less than or 20% less than the critical thrust force, it automatically sends the feedback loop signal to the controller, which controls the feed rate. As it has been established that feed rate is the main culprit which leads to the machining induced damage or the drilling induced delamination in terms of push down type of delamination. When the drill exits the hole, the push down delamination is a bigger challenge. So there can be a feedback control system, and you can have a parameter which can be a critical thrust force model. So you choose the model as per your own specific requirement. So your model will predict that this is the critical thrust force for this material. And if during the actual drilling, the thrust force is say 10-15% less than or 20% less than the critical thrust force, machining will continue. But as soon as this force will start to increase, automatically this will send a feedback signal so that the feed rate or the cutting speed is regulated in order to maintain the force within the specified limits. So that is what is another trend which is continuing, in which people are working. So another point that we can say is that the conventional machine tools like the normal drilling machines that we use in our workshops may not be the right machines for making holes in composite materials, because here we would like to have specific tools in which the tools is also correct, because as we have seen, the drill point geometry is very, very important. We can control, we can change the drill point geometry as per the composite material or the requirements of the hole, as well as we can select the machine tool also in which we can control the feed rate dynamically. So normally when we make a hole in a metallic plate, we fix the feed rate, suppose 0.3 millimeter per revolution. So it will go down with a continuous feed rate, only same feed rate. But in case of composite materials, we would like to control the feed rate during the drilling action also. That in the beginning, the feed rate is, may it can be slightly faster, quicker. You enter into the laminate, but as soon as you are going to exit the laminate, the feed rate should be controlled. It should be brought down so that you are able to slowly exit the laminate without causing any delamination. So therefore, there are a number of tools, techniques which have been investigated by the researchers to minimize the drilling induced delamination. So then we go to the drilling induced damage. You can see that there are two different drill points, parabolic point and four faces. And around the hole also you see that non-destructive die penetrant testing. This is also damaged, because once we cut the sample, this whole area also gets damaged. Why? Because of the cutting action. This is also showing the damage which has taken place. But our target is the hole, because we have created the hole. So the hole has got the damage. Now if you see something typical in this case, if you observe them properly, these are taken with same aspect ratio, both the holes with same aspect ratio. So what you can try to see here is that you have ellipse type of a damage zone. In this direction, the damage is more, and in this direction, the damage is less. So similarly, you can see here also the damage is more in this axis, and damage is less along this axis. So why this is there? Because if you remember the challenges in machining induced damage, I have told you in machining of composite material, there is a property of anisotropy. So these holes we have made in unidirectional reinforced composite material. So unidirectional are glass fiber we are using as reinforcement, and epoxy as the plastic. So our fibers are glass fibers, the matrix is a proxy. So here all fibers are in this direction. If you can see the cursor movement of cursor on your screen, all fibers are in this direction. So for unidirectional fibers, you can see the damage is along the direction of the fibers. Here also you can see the damage is along the direction of the fiber. So across the fibers you see lesser damage, along the fibers you see more damage. So we have to be careful when we are selecting these materials. Now what will happen once this plate has been drilled, what we will do, we will assemble it to some other part. So we will use a nut and a bolt and we will fasten it and we will start using it. Ignorant of the fact that there is some damage which has already taken place around the pole. And if suppose this type of a structure is under cyclic loading, this damage will further propagate along the direction of the fibers and may lead to the failure of the structure. And therefore, as engineers, we must suggest proper tools and techniques, proper methods, proper strategies to avoid this delamination or to make it more uniform all across the whole. And we have investigated that also, that if you put woven fiber, as the example I have shown you, again I will show, if you see here, there are fibers in both the directions. It is not unidirectional, it is bidirectional. So you have fibers in x direction, fibers in y direction. So in this case, if you will try to make a hole, your damage will be circular ring around the hole. So it will not have any directional property. The damage zone will not be elliptical in nature. The damage zone will be circular in nature. And then we can even further try to investigate other techniques which can reduce the extent of damage that takes place. So I think on the screen also it is clearly written unidirectional. UD means unidirectional glass fiber reinforced plastic. So the plastic in this case is epoxy. So now how to avoid this damage? So this is a summary of what we have covered. First is the selection of the optimum operating variables, then tool material selection. We have only discussed one tool material, that is high speed steel, but then we can use solid carbide also. We can coat very hard coating of materials like titanium nitride or some other very hard materials on the surface of our drills or other tools so that the tool wear can be minimized. Then the tool geometry is also important parameter, as I already told you. We have seen one step drill. There are number of types of drills we have investigated using the tree panning tool, which is a hollow tool. We have also investigated the drills which are used for making holes in wood, because this material sometimes gives us an idea, gives us an impression that it is cut like a wood. So therefore, we have tried the tools which are used for making holes in wooden materials. So that is tool point geometry is another important parameters. So we have also investigated different types of tool geometries. Then the selection of the appropriate process. This is very, very important. Normally, once we have to make a hole, we take our plate to the normal drilling machine and start making a hole. That is very, very important because we need to select the process judiciously. We need to know that this process will be suitable for making holes. So the process can be, researchers have even tried to investigate the helical feed method. Normally we feed the drill straight into the material, but the helical feed is like this. It will go down, but the feed rate will be helical in nature. So the drill will be rotating about its axis and the head will be rotating about another axis. So it reduces the thrust force. So that is another process in which people have tried to investigate. The researchers have published research articles with helical feed method also. Then sometimes what people are trying, that they are trying to put one material on top of the other. Suppose this is the plate in which you want to make, this is the composite plate. They will put one another plate below this plate. So this is called as the backup support system. So then they try to make a hole so that the lower plate will not allow the drill to cause the push down type of delamination. So they clamp the two plates together, which is called as the backup support method. So therefore, the selection of the process or the process characteristics are also very, very important. Then the dedicated machine tools. As I have already explained this, that the machines that we are going to make holes are also going to affect the damage that is taking place. Then the selection of cutting fluid, already I have told. Special methods, I told you, vibration drilling, along with, suppose this is the drill, along with the feed rate, you also give vibration to the drill, vibration assisted drilling of composite materials. If you search, you will get good articles published worldwide that vibration assisted drilling in composite materials give lesser damage as compared to the conventional machining. There are special methods also like helical feed method, which I already explained. So these are some of the methods to avoid damage in composite materials. Now the last maybe 20 minutes, 25 minutes, the two things I have already explained, the composite materials and the drilling or machining of composite material. Very basic idea I have discussed, although a lot can be discussed on these topics. I have tried to focus on three important aspects. First are the materials, second is the process, and third is the knowledge base. Now, what is the need of a knowledge base? As I have been highlighting again and again, that there are around 200 to 300 research articles which are already available in this field. So the research efforts are there, but for a particular set of workpiece, maybe for example, if I have to make a hole in this material, there may not be any information available that how to make a hole because the fiber is different. The polymer is different, so I need to do my investigation again, starting from the scratch. So research efforts are there, but for a particular set of workpiece material. Now, suppose I have done my PhD on drilling of glass fiber epoxy composite. So whatever data is generated in my PhD is only specific to glass fiber reinforced epoxy. It cannot be generalized for carbon fiber epoxy laminates. It cannot be used for jute fiber reinforced laminate. Therefore, the material or the data that is available or information that is available, that is for a particular set of workpiece material and specific tool point geometry. As we have seen in the second part of our session today, that if you change the drill point geometry, the force signal will change. And if the forces are changing, obviously the damage will also change. So therefore, the drill geometry and the workpiece combination that we have optimized may not be the right optimization for the other class of composite materials. And therefore, the efforts are largely distributed. I do my research on a specific composite material. Somebody else in maybe Brazil or US or Germany may be doing as per their own composite material and their own machine as well as their own geometry. So the efforts are there, but more or less they are divided. And they are available in different types of articles which are spread across different publishers. So the efforts are largely distributed. So what we tried to do, what we did was that we collected as much information as possible and then we brought it into one software platform. And then the information is at the back end, you will not be able to see, but at least the software will be able to come up with a predictive model that how much damage is expected in this case or how much forces are going to be generated in this case. So the researchers often spend too much time, valuable time, in searching for the relevant literature. So therefore, this tool, if you install on your system, you will be very easily able to find out that how much damage is expected and how much forces are expected if we make a hole, suppose in carbon fiber reinforced laminate with an 8 millimeter diameter drill, what will be the force and what will be the damage around the hole. So this huge data is of little value until there is a common platform to provide the relevant information. So with this objective, we developed a database. So the objective of this initiative was to develop a knowledge base tool to help engineers and scientists with their specific queries regarding the feed rate, cutting speed, tool point geometry, and the reference for the detailed study. Now, suppose one research article is already reporting on the specific requirements which the user is giving to this knowledge base. So automatically it will search and it will bring that article in the output and the user can download that article from the relevant. We are not providing the links to the research article, but we are only providing the detail of the article that this article focus on your query, so you can download it from whatever website it is available. So our target was to design a tool that saves valuable time of researchers and scientists and is easy to use. So the emphasis was that it must be as precise as possible, although it cannot be 100% precise, accurate. It must be specific. Suppose you are asking for glass fiber, it should only give you the output related to glass fiber only. it must not take lot of time to search, and then it must be a continuous upgradation process must be there, that as soon as we get 10 new papers in last 6 months on that topic, it must be upgraded in that platform. So the knowledge base, this was created after a detailed literature review. It is difficult to extract the information. Normally some researchers give their information in the form of graph. So that graph, we took that graph as an input, and using the CorelDRAW, we were able to get the coordinates, and accordingly we were able to extract the information. So then the information was put together in the form of a code which was used in developer C++, and the generated code is ready to use as a knowledge base. So normally these are the steps how it works that I'll share with you. It asks, it we were able to create a graphic user interface also. So it asks the user for conventional and non-conventional drilling of FRP. So the first question is whether the user wants to investigate the conventional machining or the unconventional machining. Second one is it provides options for drilling with special conditions, like I have already told you. Few articles are already available in which the users or the researchers, or not the users, the researchers have already investigated the using the backup plate and or under the cryogenic conditions, or they want to study the vibration assisted in drilling. So step three is the take the input form. We will ask the user, the software will ask the user, what is the fiber you are going to use, what is the matrix material you are going to use, what is the tool point geometry. So in tool point geometry, the user will click on the scroll down menu, and a list of geometries will be displayed. Then out of those, he can or she can select the one best geometry which they feel, because they don't know that which geometry will give how much damage. But then based on their understanding, they will select one geometry, and then the display most relevant result to the user regarding his query with the references. So then the system will automatically run, and then it will be able to display that what is the most relevant result to the user regarding the input parameters which he or she has specified. Now what will be the output of this knowledge base? So the previous one is all our how it works. These are the inputs, and what is the output? So the output of, in case of conventional drilling, can be feed rate, it can be cutting speed, it can be thrust force, as I told you, it can be torque, it can be critical thrust force also, if that is available in that research article, surface roughness of the hole, damage factor or damage area around the hole, or the relevant critical thrust force model. So different types of output depending upon different types of research articles can be there. This is a generic list of the output that we can get from the knowledge base. Now for non-conventional drilling, there are articles available on ultrasonic drilling. So this will be able to generate the output in terms of the abrasive size, surface roughness achieved, the hole clearance, the repetition rate, etc. Similarly for laser drilling, similarly for water jet drilling. So this is the overview of the input that the software will ask. This is the overview of the input. We can see the drilling of fiber reinforced plastic. So our target is to develop this knowledge base. First question will be conventional drilling or non-conventional drilling. In non-conventional, these are the processes which have already been investigated by the researchers. This is conventional drilling without special condition, with special condition. Special condition is putting a backup plate, vibration drilling, cryogenic conditions. So the drilling is done under very, very low temperature, that is under cryogenic condition. And then the drill point geometry, you can see the list. There's a long list of drill points which the researchers have already investigated for making good quality holes in composite material. So the information related to all this will be available in the software platform. So that is, you can say, one of the advantage of this type of a platform. So we are not directly going to wherever the direct information is available, it will give, but wherever the direct information is not available, it can even predict. So input, it will go to the knowledge base tool, and then as we have seen, what will be the output of this whole program? The output for conventional drilling will be feed rate, cutting speed, drill diameter, tool wear, drill eccentric ratio, or it can be critical thrust force, torque. Similarly, non-conventional drilling for ultrasonic, as we have already seen. So instead of going into this, the time is already going to be over. Let us take some of the results of the knowledge base. Now the user specified input, so this is the outcome of our knowledge base that we were able to create. The user specified that I want to do conventional drilling. He has not specified any special condition for this drilling action. Tool point geometry selected by the user was saw drill. The fiber selected by the user was carbon fiber, and the matrix selected was epoxy. So this is the graphic user interface input values, GUI input given by the user. Now the knowledge base was able to generate the output in terms of the theoretical critical thrust force 38.8 newton, experimental critical thrust force 28.6 newton, critical feed rate 5.1 into 10 to the power minus 3 millimeter per revolution. So we are not going to expose all the details of the research article to the user. So if the user is further interested, we are giving the details of the reference, that this information is related to your query and you can get your detailed information from this paper, which is published by H. Ho Chang and C. C. Sao. So this paper gives this information which is directly fitting to your requirement. So this is just one output or input output relation. The second one is the user again selected the conventional drilling approach. He specified twist drill, carbon fiber, epoxy, and then the knowledge base generated output based on the already in the database. Already these two papers, the output of these two papers is already available. So it was able to tell that if you are using a 5 mm thick plate, this will be the critical thrust force and this will be the critical feed rate. It should be less than 0.001 millimeter per revolution. Similarly for 9 mm. This is another case that this is the input and that is the output. So the papers are not exactly displayed, only the link is given so that the user can make use of these papers to further enhance his or her information. So the only thing that this knowledge base is helping in way that, for example, after looking for the articles even for 2 months, the user may not be able to find out these two specific articles which are relevant to the research work. Therefore, now it is only by putting the input directly, he or she is able to get the relevant literature which they can further investigate and find out that how they can use this information for making. Now, some of you may be wondering that how this is helping in making good quality holes, because our target is to produce good quality hole. So we can produce the good quality hole by controlling our thrust force now. So our thrust force, critical thrust force, is the level of the force beyond which the damage will take place. So if the force goes beyond this value, the damage is going to take place. So if the software is helping us to find out that limit, so we will obviously be selecting our input parameters like cutting speed and feed rate so that we do not generate critical thrust force which is greater than these values. So obviously indirectly we are controlling the quality of our holes also. This is another non-conventional, the user selected non-conventional method. Process detail is water jet, fiber is specified, matrix is specified. Again we are helping the user with the research article in which the information is available, and we are helping him to find, to select the theoretical critical water jet pressure and the experimental critical water jet pressure. So he can now keep the water jet pressure in this range in order to make a good quality hole using the process of water jet cutting of carbon fiber and epoxy. So what can be the future aspects for this? So this is one tool which is created. Now there can be many times issues related to that you are not exactly getting the fiber that you have selected. For example, you choose the hen feather or the human hair as a reinforcement, the research is not available and the properties are not available. So that is what I told you in the very beginning, that this can be upgraded as and when more and more research articles are published. Second thing can be that this can be put as a backup. It can be put in the background of any controller. For example, there are machine tools. Now we have to make the hole on a machine. Now this machine will be controlled by a computer. In the computer, we can have this software which will run in the background and will help us to choose the parameters as per the knowledge base which is already available. So what can be the input more specific? We can, as I already told you, human hair, reinforced composite materials, the work material information can be upgraded, updated time to time. Output can also be changed, and maybe we are incorporating more data from research papers and conferences. This also I have already. Now suppose one is interested in see the trends, then obviously the researchers will have to refer to the research article, download the article from the publisher's website and read the article in detail. But this will help, this system will help is the selection of the parameters for controlling the machine, as well as the very, very specific articles the user will be able to find out, which are directly relevant to his or her research or his or her material in the industry in which they want to make the code. So I think my time is going to be over. So I will wind up now. So this is a summary, and this I will skip. So maybe that is all from my side.
Okay, sir.
We can thank have you, questions, because then there will be another session maybe.
Ji, sir.
I have some other data that how to generate data for this type of a knowledge base. So we can use finite element modeling, but that we can skip. Maybe we can directly go to the questions.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. The participants, if you have any doubt, then you can ask to sir. Participants, if you have any doubt, then you can ask.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, actually, I was having one question, and I have written in chat box that for drilling the hole, the abrasive water jet machining can be used or not. But as soon as I put up the question, you have just scrolled the side and you mentioned that the water jet machining. So I can ask the question in other round. First, the abrasive water jet machining can be used or not? And if we use a non-conventional machining, then I think is it better than the conventional machining to produce a hole in? So which one is better? I think conventional or non-conventional, which one is better?
Yeah, this is a very good question. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, we are working in this area of machining of composite materials, I think, for last maybe 20 years. Maybe when I did my PhD, I joined in 2000, and this is 2020. So, what we have done, we have already studied the conventional machining of composite materials as well as unconventional machining of composite material. So normally I have another slide because the time is again a limitation. Normally we do courses for 5 days on processing of composite materials and talk about machining for 2 days on that topic.
Yes, sir.
The question is very, very relevant, and my suggestion here is that it is the tool and workpiece interaction that will decide whether conventional machining is better or unconventional machining is better. For example, we have used ultrasonic machining of composite materials. One of my students, Dr. Kishore Devnath, who is currently working at NIT Meghalaya, he worked on ultrasonic machining of composite materials. So we have chosen glass fiber and epoxy as the composite, and then we were able to make good quality holes. So we were finding a lot of delamination is taking place if we use conventional hole making process or conventional drilling in glass fiber epoxy laminates. But when we use ultrasonic hole making technique in glass fiber laminates, we were able to completely eliminate the delamination that takes place. but when we were doing ultrasonic drilling, we saw some black spots on the whole wall, which later on, while with the emery paper, we were able to remove. So we different processes will give you different behavior. But obviously, as I have told you, that once we are using conventional machining or conventional drilling of composite materials, specifically the laminated composite, the push-down delamination is a big problem, and it is leading to 60% hole rejection. So if somehow in non-conventional machining we are able to avoid the contact between the tool and the workpiece, obviously the problem of thrust force will be taken care of, and we will be able to reduce the effect of push down type of delamination. But then suppose we use any unconventional method which is heavy, which is going to generate lot of temperature, for example electric discharge machining, the matrix which in this case may burn. So matrix burning may be a big challenge, and quality of the hole may be reduced. So therefore, depending upon the type of workpiece material and the type of process, we will have to do a trade-off that which process can be used for which type of material. And as your first question, that whether we can use water jet cutting for composite materials, I must share this information with you that IIT Delhi have got a grant for setting up of a lab in which they are going to work on the impact of composite material. So they have bought a very large size compression molding machine, and they have bought a water jet cutting machine for cutting the laminate into specific dimensions. So obviously it is clear now that water jet cutting can be used for cutting or machining of composite materials. So I think I have answered both your questions. We have to judiciously select that whether unconventional will be better or whether conventional will be better. Even for as you can see, the glass fiber is non-conductive electricity. It is used as an insulator. Polymer is also non-conductive. So when glass fiber and polymer both are non-conductive, we cannot use any electricity-based process like electrochemical machining or electric discharge machining. So therefore, the right matching process and the material has to be worked out.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Any other question from participants? Sir, I think it's okay. No more questions from participants. And thank you very much, sir, for giving the valuable insights about the composite materials. And hope all the participants for all the participants this session will be beneficial. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you all of you.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, may I stop the meeting? Okay, thank
you. Can stop.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for.
Okay.
So I request all the participants to join in the next session. Thank you very much.